Poseidon was kind of angry that, you know, so he flooded the place. So to please him, they built a temple at the Acropolis. The Acropolis hill was actually sacred to Athena because, you know, they both appeared here. Then they created a joint temple to both Athena and Poseidon, which was called the Erechtheion. And in the Erechtheion, there are like these scratch marks, which people say that these are the, you know, scratches from Poseidon's trident when he made the salt water spring. Can still be seen there. And that's all the myths that I have to discuss. And now moving on to old lady. I think this is a famous trope in, you know, literature these days. Somebody who disguises an old lady, and then they would come, and if the, you know, person doesn't react accordingly, they would be furious. It's kind of like that. What happens is that, so Athena goes down to Arachne's, like, oh, let's see what's up with this girl. She went down there as an old lady. She tried to tell Arachne, oh, don't say that, dearie. You know, Athena might forgive you if you, you know, amend right now. She's like, you know, if Athena is so nice, Athena might have been taught by me. You know, we could have a contest, she said. It was enough for Athena. She, you know, burned away her disguise. She was like, you called for me? I'm here now. I accept the challenge. Arachne was kind of, you know, she must have been scared inside having a full goddess in front of her. And Arachne said, all right, let's accept the challenge. You know, let's get going. And then they continued to insult each other in the language of tapestries. Athena wove a tapestry full of the, you know, the gods' praises and, you know, all the gods doing heroic deeds and saving the world and everything. Meanwhile, Arachne did the total opposite. Now, I'm pretty sure Arachne had a lot to choose from because the Greek gods were so, like, they were known for being rebellious themselves, even though they were gods, which just makes us thankful for our own religion. So, she wove the gods' disgraces. She wove different scenes from, you know, different tales. Then what happened was that when they were finished weaving, Athena looked at her tapestry and she's like, yeah, you've done good. You're really talented. The colors and the thread is blended really nicely. Why not something else? Now, I'm pretty sure all of the women know how annoying spider webs are. They weave, don't they? They weave webs. So Athena said, okay, you like to weave so much? Weave forever. Soak in your generations. That's what happened. And that's where we get the word arachnid from. Arachnid, something that has eight legs and, you know, it's from, the spiders, it's called an arachnid. Spider and species like this, they're called the arachnids because of arachnid. Now we ask, how do we call it fact? The fact is that modesty is virtue. Arachne was talented. She was really talented. In fact, she might have even been better than Athena. But modesty is virtue, like I said. If we are extremely proud of ourselves, and if we're extremely, you know, happy with our wealth, and if we're extremely bragging, there's a term for it actually. It's called hubris. Urdu mein kehte hain ghurur aur takabbur. Yes, pride has fallen. Exactly. So that's, I think that's the moral of the story. And anybody who would want to know, it's mentioned in Ovid's Metamorphoses. Already mentioned that. And now we have kind of an interesting story. I think the political people would kind of like this. Me and Dad were discussing it last time, and it was quite fun. So I'm pretty sure. Most of the people might not know about this because it's not mentioned a lot throughout history, but it wasn't there yet. When Achilles was telling his mom to go plead Zeus, okay, you've done this for him, that for him, now go ask Zeus to help me. So what happened was that Hera, Athena, Poseidon, they tried to overthrow Zeus. Now they formed an alliance which is really peculiar because Athena and Poseidon were rivals. They didn't like each other from the beginning. They didn't like each other, Athena and Poseidon. So it was kind of weird that, okay, you guys are teaming up? That's weird. It's like enemies suddenly, you know, in the same department for, because they both hate the same person. That's, people might know that because he's teaching strategies and everything. So then they formed an alliance. Hera, she was the, wife of Zeus. She said, you know, I'll put him to, you know, I'll give him a potion or something in his drink, and then, you know, he'll fall asleep, and then you guys can come in and chain him up. That's exactly what they did. They chained him up. And if you tried to shape shift,
you make a reference, PDM teaming up against Imran Khan.
Exactly. That was what I was gonna say. Teaming up against Imran Khan. I don't know, his So it's really interesting. So they teamed up and they tried to chain him up, and he couldn't do anything about it. He was helpless. He kept roaring and everything. His lightning bolts were on the other side of the room. And and then they ran away. बाहर से तो सारे कह रहे थे ओ हम काउंसिल ऑफ इक्वल्स हैं हम सारे मिलके रूल करेंगे इट वुड बी अ डेमोक्रेसी लेकिन अंदर से सारे सोच रहे थे ये सारे जरा मसरूफ हो जाए ना मैं फिर आके मैं रूलर कर दूंगा कॉस्मोस का सो देन फिर उन्होंने क्या किया कि अब ज्यूस जो था वो चीखना चल रहा था अपने रूम में एंड देन देयर वाज दिस देयर वाज दिस नेरी देयर पोसाइडन स्पेशल क्रिएचर्स बट द नेरी थीटिस Now people might know him as Achilles' mom. She was Achilles' mother, and she was a former wife of Zeus. Because there was this prophecy about Thetis that her son would be greater than his father. So Zeus obviously he said, okay, no, nobody can be more powerful than me. You have to go. So then Thetis married Peleus, and then they had Achilles who was greater than Peleus himself. So that prophecy was settled. Now, Thetis, she heard him, and she was like, okay, that looks like trouble. She went in there, and she saw what was wrong, and then she was a nymph, obviously. She couldn't, untie the chains herself. So, she called this, if anybody knows about how the world is created, the Greek world, how they thought they was created, they might know Gaia and Uranus. Now Gaia and Uranus had these triplets, the 100-handed ones, hecatomb fairies. What one of them, Briareus, they had like 100 hands and 50 faces. I know that sounds gruesome. I don't even know how it's possible to have 100 hands and 50 faces. But anyways, he did. Then she called him up and then she untied him. And then Zeus went and was like, okay, now we got some explaining to do. Now, what he, how he punished them was he hung Hera over the abyss of chaos. Now, chaos is also a word that we get from Greek mythology. It literally means the gap or the opening. In mythology, it means the gap or the opening. So, he hung her over chaos. Now, Athena, she was the goddess of wisdom. She must have done some clever talking, and she got out of it. She went away, punished her. Her voice is on it. Then Poseidon, now he gave Poseidon a really funny punishment. He stripped away his immortality. He made him immortal and he sent him to King Laomedon. Now King Laomedon was the king of Troy. So the walls around Troy were actually built by Poseidon. He built the walls of Troy. And then he went to Laomedon and was like, okay, what about my reward? And he was like, reward? What reward? Now, Poseidon had promised that he wouldn't, annoy the Trojans or, destroy them. But he did send the Trojan sea monster there. Perseus, I think, killed the Trojan sea monster. The Troy's walls were built by Poseidon, and in the Trojan War, Poseidon was never thrown him, but then Thetis comes to his rescue. And then, do you guys feel as if it's kind of, as if it's like a strategy that could read the whole game because it's too long? But Achilles is telling his mom, okay, you did all of that for Zeus, so now go get the favor back. Now another one that we have, it's another interesting story, as I like to call it. Aegipan and Typhon. This story is kind of, I think it's undermined. Now everyone knows about Typhon and Zeus. Typhon and Zeus, it's a famous story, generally. This is, it's mentioned in quite a lot of works. It's mentioned in Hesiod's stories, Aeschylus' stories, Pindar's and Apollo. sons, even though Zeus was her own grandson. She didn't care about it. She was like, okay, now you're going to punish. You're going to be punished. So she sent a monster. She sent a monster up there. He was called Typhon. He had, zodiac signs are really like trendy these days. So when Aegipan was escaping Typhon, he transformed into a goat with a fish's tail. So as a reward for how he had saved them, Zeus turned that into a constellation. And we know that constellation as Capricorn. We know that as Capricorn these days. So the goat and the fishtail thing, that's where it came from. And here we are. Now I have, this is a bonus story. I included it in here because it was really interesting. And it showed that, now we all know that the word, now I think the first thing that I studied in social studies when I was in fourth grade or something was that the word democracy comes from Greek. And now we have a demonstration that it exactly did come from Greek. Because what happened is that, now it was like really trendy to, at that time it was really trendy to be the patron god of a city. So what happened was that Athena and Poseidon, they both wanted to take over Athens. They wanted to be the patron god of Athens. Now guessing by the name, we can all already guess that who became the patron from Athena and Poseidon. So they both went there and they said, okay, let's make you guys decide. There was a king, Kecrops. The king Kecrops, he had to decide, and the people had to decide, which god did they want as their patron. Now both gods gave the Athenians something. Now, first of all, Poseidon created horses. It is a well-known fact in mythology that Poseidon created horses. Poseidon created horses for the Athenians, and he said that okay, they can carry heavy loads, they can travel fast over distances. Athens was a really hilly place, so there wasn't much use for horses there. Then he created a saltwater spring there. A saltwater spring in a hillside. They didn't have much use for that either because it was surrounded by water. Now it was Athena's turn. She planted something in the soil, and when she stood up, it was a tree. It was an olive tree. Now, the olive tree, Athena said, you know, this can be used as oil. It can be eaten as food. It can also be, it can make a good like moisturizer and everything. It can be traded. Now, the Athenians didn't want to hear more. They were like, Athena, we're all yours. And then that's how the city got to get its name. Athens is actually from Athena. But now Poseidon was kind of angry that, you know, so he flooded the place. So to please him, they built a temple at the Acropolis. The Acropolis Hill was actually sacred to Athena because, you know, they both appeared there. Then they created a joint temple to both Athena and Poseidon, which was called the Erechtheion. And in the Erechtheion, there are like these scratch marks, which people say that these are the, you know, scratches from Poseidon's trident when he made the saltwater spring. It can still be seen there. And that's all the myths that I have to discuss. And now moving on towards why did we discuss all of this? Because of, in these examples, like, we can see how much they reflect on our modern day world. We can see how many things that are derived from there. We can see how much influence we have from there. And it's really amazing. The religion is like, so the Greek religion, it's kind of similar to ours. We say that, okay, these were just a bunch of stories. Can we say that? Now, our God has similar methods, doesn't he? We have in our Quran, we have so many tales of our prophets and people of Samud and people of the Pharaoh, and all of those are also lessons for us, aren't they? They're lessons for us, and these are also lessons for us. There are a lot of surahs. I forgot the one you told me last
night.
The Byzantine, yes. Now, we have a whole surah on Greek, so we can't really, you know, undermine that. The Byzantine surah, Surah Rum, I think. That's the whole thing based on Greeks. So, I think so many stories are, you know, similar to their religion. first of all, like I said, the Pandora thing relating with Adam and Eve. Another thing, another story that relates to our religion was the story of Deucalion and Pyrrha. So what happened was that Zeus wasn't still wasn't done with human punishing. He said, okay, I'm going to flood the whole place. Now that also rings a lot of bells for us. That, okay, we've heard that somewhere before. Then what happened was that two people, Deucalion and Pyrrha, they also got something from, they also received some message from Prometheus that packed something up. So they both hid in a chest. It's like a suitcase sort of thing, but of ancient times. So they went hid in there, and then when the flood was over, they came out, and then they went to the Oracle of Delphi. The Oracle of Delphi is a really interesting figure in history. Not in history, like in Greek mythology, it's still there. So it was considered the, you know, center of the world. They consider it the center.
Once here, for the students of IR, Adelphi papers came from this myth as well. If you are interested, go and find Delphi papers.
For the students of literature, you must have read in Sophocles.
So the Oracle of Delphi, Deucalion and Pyrrha, they went to the Oracle of Delphi. Like, okay, Delphi, what do we do? And he said, throw the bones of your mother behind.